Hi, welcome to this broadcast from the National Local Government Customer Service Network. In this broadcast, we've got a really great speaker. Her name's Karen, and she's from a really important body. The body that she's from is from the Australian Centre for Excellence in Local Government. Now, that's a bit of a mouthful. But you see, the thing is about what Karen's going to say is that everyone in your organisation really needs to pay attention. Some really great information. Enjoy it, but take lots of notes because the information is vital. Hi Karen, welcome to the Local Government Customer Service Network Conference up here in Tweed Heads. Now Karen, you're from the Australian Centre for Excellence for Local Government. Now,
that's right.
What does that mean and what do you guys do?
Basically, we're a federally funded organisation who has oversight of local government around the country. And you might realise that local government is very different state by state,
yes.
Jurisdiction by jurisdiction. And we're a consortium of partners are based at UTS. We work with a number of universities and we conduct research into local government. We disseminate research. We advise on policy. We don't write policy, but we advise. And basically our remit is to lift the game of local government, to help it to be as good as it can be.
So what brings you to this particular conference at this time?
I'm here to speak specifically about research that we've conducted into social media use in local government. We did a national survey. We looked at how councils are using social media, what the barriers are to the use, how social media can enable local government. It's making local government think about being more responsive and having more of a two-way conversation with the community. And the important thing for local government to realise more than anything is that it's not about whether they decide to be part of social media or not, because the party's already happening, and whether they go to the party or not, it's already out there. People are already discussing local government on social media, and that's where people want to be having their conversations and living their lives, and local government really needs to be part of that.
So with the wave of social media that's coming, I mean, the conference is entitled The Wave of the Future.
Yes.
So we are part of a future wave, whether we like it or not. Social media is coming to us.
That's exactly right. And the other thing that I say in the presentation is to caution people is whenever people in local government talk about social media, they talk about whether they're on Facebook or if it should be Twitter or whatever. None of that matters. It's about the ethos of how you communicate, because none of those tools will be there in another 2 or 3 years. If we'd done it 5 years ago, we'd all have been talking about a whole different set of social media tools that don't even exist today. So it's not about the specific tools, it's about how you communicate. And if you build a framework about communication, then as the tools change, they'll...
So it doesn't matter whether it's MySpace or Facebook.
That's right.
What matters is that we're moving in the right direction,
yep,
with the tools, not the names of the tools.
That's right. I think social media means a fundamental change in moving councils from we know best and we'll tell you, we'll give you the information we think you need to know, to a much more collaborative form of working together. And that's partly because of funding. Local government won't have the funding to provide all the services, so they'll need to collaborate with the community to do that. It's an enormously enabling tool for local government, as it is for anyone else in the community, and it's really important that they embrace that and move forward.
So this is a relationship change rather than a technological change?
Oh yes, it's completely not about the technology. I mean, there's a lot of technology behind it, but technology comes and goes. Mm. It really is about relationships, and it's about a philosophy of how you communicate.
Well, thank you very much for today, Karen. I'm really looking forward to hearing your speech and hearing
thank
what you have to
me.
Say from the Australian Centre for Excellence for Local Government.
Thank you. I'm the project manager at the Centre of Excellence for Local Government. We are a unique collaboration of universities and bodies committed to the advancement of local government. We're federally funded and we're put in place for 8 years, and we're in our fourth year now. Basically, our remit is for world-class local government to meet the emerging challenges of the 21st century. So that's what we do. Effectively, we sponsor academic research and practitioner-based research. We look at research from around the world, not just in Australia. We turn that into more easily digestible and accessible information and put it out there for local government. Local government is so different on a state-by-state basis. You sort of imagine that councils are councils across the country, and that might be a sensible position, but no, in each state has their own legislation, their own requirements, and their own challenges. So while you have a lot in common, nationally, there are also a lot of differences. We have program areas in research and policy foresight, so that was what I was speaking about. Innovation and best practice, it's our job to develop, to source and find innovation and share that with councils. Governance and strategic leadership, organisational capacity building, rural, remote and Indigenous government and workforce development. So we do research in all of those areas and disseminate it out to the sector. Looking at social media, you need to do that in context of the challenges facing local government, and Rum spoke eloquently about them this morning. Specifically though, local government has increasingly to deliver a very diverse range of services. Governments in all states are devolving services to local government as fast as they can, on the basis that, of course, you're best placed to provide them, but they're not giving you any money to back that up, so that just stretches you more. By the same token, community expectations are really increasing, and that's because as they deal with other organisations, they're finding customer service is more timely. They can contact, if you have a problem with your mobile phone call centre is going to be open until at least 10 o'clock at night, if not 24/7. So when you go to ring council and it says at 5 past 5, I'm sorry, our offices are only manned from, that's a bit frustrating. So people get a bit anxious about that now because they're used to getting higher standards of delivery or different standards of delivery in other areas. Legislative requirements, again, I'll talk a bit about record keeping and what a nightmare that is for councils in a minute, and just the volume of records and information, and the diverse workforce. Council workforces are incredibly diverse. They are ageing. They also have a really broad range of education. There are still a proportion of council workers who didn't finish school. There are also some literacy issues. Not just in rural and remote councils, but also in metro councils, as there are in lots of workplaces. That's not just a local government thing. And different computer skills. And the different computer skills is a real issue about the introduction of technology, and that's because the different computer skills are not necessarily at the bottom of the council sort of workforce, although in some of your outdoor staff, that might be a bit of an issue, but often not, and that's a bit of a misconception, because your outdoor staff who don't have access to computers at work will often go home, hop on Facebook and talk to their kids who are overseas or use Twitter or whatever. So it's not all about that bottom end. It's often about the really top end, and that's where you get a lot of blocking for technology in councils, and that's your CEO who's never opened an email. Your CEO has got someone to open his emails and print them off for him because he doesn't do that. That's your blockage. It's that lack of computer technology, it's the lack of using social media, it's the lack of accessing any of that stuff. And they're the people who say no within organisations. So part of our research program, we did a survey of all councils in Australia and we asked them about their use of social media. Now this is back in late 2011, so these figures are a year and a bit old, and it's fair to say that the social media market has changed considerably since then. However, then at that time, 70% of councils were using social media and had a social media presence of some sort. Now that's a lot. I know that now, as of last week, there were 340 council Twitter accounts. Now there are only 556 councils, I think, in the country. The advantage of using YouTube, if you don't know, Google, who own YouTube, give all government departments in Australia, including local government, free branded YouTube channels. So they take the YouTube branding off and you brand it yourself. One of the concerns for local government in using YouTube and Facebook and all of those things is that you put information up, but then you don't own it. So with your website, you put information up, technically you own it, you keep records of it, you can take it down. Once you put something on Facebook or Google Plus or any of those things, it's actually really hard to get it redacted. And Facebook particularly can use that information in any way they like. That's part of their user agreement. So that is a bit of a concern for councils. With the YouTube though, Google are very clear about how you can own that data, they don't own it and they can't do anything else with it. So that's a really useful thing. Some councils use it internally for training. So that, you know, you do one training session, you film it, you ask questions, you make it interactive, and then you've got it on your intranet for all your new staff can just access the training that way instead of having to keep running the same training over and over again. You can also use it to make training available to your community groups. You can interview community leaders. You can have sort of talking head talks about projects that are going on. Lots of different things you can do, and you can do it all under your own banner. There are a lot of really active local government groups where you can just go and share professional information, so communities of interest. So this is a really important thing for you guys, because who drives social media use in local government? It's not you. It's communications. Okay, communications own social media. Where a council has social media, communications develop the social media policy as part of the communications policy. They lock it down, they own it, and they use it. Communications in local government traditionally are about broadcast communications. They are about, we will give you, the community, the information we think you need at a time we think you need it, in the format we think you want it. And that's what communications do, and it's about council brand, it's about not damaging the brand, it's about having a consistent approach. It's not about genuine community engagement, which is what customer service does, because you're the people talking to the customers. And you're the people, the customers are saying, well, I actually don't like that. I don't want it to happen this way, I want it to happen that way. It would be better for me if such and such. And sadly, in many customer service operations, there's no way of capturing that feedback. So you can say somebody rang because their bin didn't get collected, but if they say, and by the way, I'd just like to give you this feedback about such and such, I'm not really happy about such and such, or I didn't like what you said in the annual report about so and so, do you have a way of capturing that and feeding it back into the organisation? So it's really important that you guys, because you're out there talking to the community all the time, have the ability to do that, and that social media is a way of making that easier for you, but it's a way that currently is locked into communications. Technology security issues, sometimes that's true, sometimes that's shorthand for I don't want to. And I always say in local government, whenever anybody says risk, oh, what about the risk, there's always risk. And risk is great, you know, I only have to say risk and you senior manager go, well, there's risk, sorry, we're not there. Think about the risk of not doing it. Everyone always talks about the risk of doing it. The risk is this. Well, what about the risk of not doing it? The risk of not doing it is that your community's out there having conversations about you that you're not privy to, or worse, not having conversations about you. And here's the thing local government needs to think about. Yes, there are changes coming. Yes, there are amalgamations being talked about in not only New South Wales, but all over the place. Local government's going to be under a lot of pressure to change, to pull back, to withdraw some of their services, to be much more effective. And who is going to be your biggest champion in fighting against that? It's going to be the community. Because if your community says, hang on a minute, we love these services that local government give us, they're important, local government partners with us, they talk to us, we understand what they do, they'll champion local government to the other tiers of government. If they say, local government, I don't even know what they do, but they didn't pick up my bin last month, and the government says, well, we're going to take money off them, we're going to change them, we're going to do that, you aren't going to get any interest from your community at all. So there's another reason for you to be much more connected to your community and to give your community an opportunity to feel much more connected with you, and I would say that's a really big one. At record keeping issues comes up as a really big one, and that comes up as a risk too, so I'll talk about that. The risks again, negative community feedback, council bashing and reputational risk. I really don't think that is a risk. I think you need to acknowledge that can happen and have a plan to mitigate it. That's it. And then move on. That's not a reason for not doing anything. Lack of resources and time consuming. Yes, it is in the beginning, but in actual fact, once you start doing it, it can be much more effective use of your time, and it can certainly save some time in terms of dealing with customer complaints. Also, it's a really great way of identifying issues before they become issues. So mostly council doesn't hear about community issues until it's been out there bubbling away in the community for a really long time. And then it's a big thing, and then council has to deal with it, you know, deal with a capital D in a major way. If council's monitoring social media, if they're on the Facebook and Twitter, they'll pick up those issues long before they become issues. And they can often head them off at the pass. And sometimes it's just a matter of perception, and if they can address that perception early enough, then they don't have a big issue to deal with later on. Technology security issues. There are some issues, as I said, with Facebook. When you sign up for Facebook, in the very, 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 very fine print, it says, you know what, we own anything, you own nothing. If we want to change it, move it, delete it, any of that, it's entirely up to us, and you have no recourse. And that's fine if you're putting stuff up you don't care about, like they can move around, it really doesn't matter, and you're keeping other records of it. I wouldn't rely on the Facebook timeline, because while it's really good while it's there, it does sometimes disappear, and then you can't get it, so for no apparent reason. So, you know, I would have some other backing up things. I'm not saying don't use Facebook. Be conscious of, there is some legislation, I believe, coming out around cloud, use of cloud computing for local government. There's some issue about, there's a bit of an issue about sovereign rights, sovereign data, which is, I suspect, not as big an issue as it seems. Nevertheless, you need to be aware about where some of that stuff's being kept. Did you all know, though, that as part of record keeping for your websites, you have to back up your websites every night so that if somebody asks, you can show exactly what that picture looked like on any particular day? Okay, so local government has to do that all the time. So if somebody says, I saw that on the website on the 17th of November 2006, your council has to be able to show the website on the 17th of November 2006. So that's a record keeping thing. You just need to identify the tools to do it with and make sure that you have them in place. Litigation. You are covered on social media by exactly the same libel laws, for example, that you would be on any other type of media. So if you send out a press release, if you said, well, that's a matter again of training. And also code of conduct. You can't say bad things about people under your code of conduct. So really, if in doubt, always fall back on your code of conduct, but no reason why you couldn't have specific training about how to use different forms of social media. And people said it'll increase community expectations. People will expect us to be better. And, sorry, we're not having any of that. Because once that starts, who knows where it stops. Yes, it will, but the truth of it is community expectations are being increased anyway, and they're being increased by dealings with all sorts of organisations that aren't local government. But they will have an expectation that their dealings with you will be similar to their dealings with those other organisations. And when they're not, then they'll be really disappointed.
Thanks for watching the broadcast today. We hope you really enjoyed it. We hope you got lots of tips and lots of tricks that you're able to use and take back to your council. And we're really looking forward to seeing you next time on the next broadcast. Bye for now.